thanks, Manuel, and also thank you for coming. So I felt that you spent a bit of time at the beach yesterday, so I appreciate it even more that you're here and not at the beach now. So in the second part, I would like to discuss a few methods for cultural discovery. Maybe a tiny bit of recap. No, this is not working. Good now, yes. So this is what we did yesterday, right? So we constructed these, or we looked at these structural equation models. These are causal models, and we got a causal graph out of them, a joint distribution, and these interventional distributions. And now maybe as a side remark, so of course, so this is all what we sometimes call the population case. So we have full knowledge about the distribution, but in practice, of course, we most often only have a finite sample from this. And usually this is what you do in statistics, right? So in probability theory, you would say, well, you have a distribution, an underlying distribution, and then you are computing, I don't know, distributions of the sample mean, for example. This is what some people would call probabilistic reasoning. Sorry. And then in statistics, we are doing the other way around, right? So we are starting with the finite sample from a joint distribution, and then we are inferring properties of the joint distribution. Let's say, you know, it's the most boring task ever, but it's still often done. So you have the Gaussian distribution, you get some data, and now you're wondering what is the underlying variance. And this is exactly this problem, right? So you have a finite sample, and you're trying to infer something about the joint distribution. So now, what are we doing in causal discovery? So there, we are given, for example, only the joint distribution, and then we are wondering what is the underlying causal structure, what is the underlying structural equation model, or what you can also ask is what is the underlying causal graph. Okay, and so I would like to point out that this is slightly different from the usual problem of statistics in the sense that even if someone gives you the full distribution, you're not done, right? So in statistics, sort of, you can all the problems are gone if someone is giving you the correct distribution, because then you just have to read off the properties, right? But here it's not the case. So even if someone gives you the full distribution, this task of recovering the causal structure is not trivial. And then, of course, in practice, what we would like to have is a method that takes even a finite sample and then constructs something like an estimate of the causal structure. But here, first, I would like to focus on this part, because even this is not trivial, and then later on I will discuss what happens if you're not given the joint distribution, but rather the finite sample. Okay, so the problem clear? Very good. So here, maybe a comment. So if you want to do this, somehow we have to relate the distribution P and the structural equation model. Otherwise, there's no hope, right? And this is what we will do in the sort of first minutes. We will try to somehow relate the joint distribution, and what we will do is we will relate it to the causal graph, and the two important concepts there are the Markov assumption and the faithfulness assumption. So this we will see in a second. Okay, so that's the problem we are trying to solve here. And so a rough overview, we will see three different ideas, hopefully a kind of others. And I try to not go into too much detail, but rather try to provide you with the ideas of how to do this step here. Okay, so this is the picture that some of you may know, if you're a second to read it. So I used to think correlations like causation, then I took a statistics class, no, I don't, it sounds like a class help around maybe. Right? This is the sort of the usual story, correlation is not causation. And so the question is, how do we ever want to find out the causal structure? Okay, so here is the statement, right? Correlation. I don't know why people always say correlation, so I think it's more accurate to say dependence. Dependence does not imply causation, but there's a but here. So there's something that is called the Reichenbach-Schwarz principle, and so I have the impression that most of the people that at least I talk to agree to this principle. So what does it say? Assume you have two random variables that are dependent. Then somehow, at least subconsciously, I think we are always looking for a causal explanation for this. So when you see the graph between, when I showed you the graph that shows the correlation between chocolate and Nobel Prize winners, somehow we always start to think, well, where does this come from, right? And then one thinks for, like, looks for some explanation. For example, chocolate is causing Nobel Prizes, seems unlikely, but maybe we are looking for common causes. And this is the common cause principle from Reichenbach. So it states whenever you find a dependence between two variables, then either X causes Y, and this could be an indirect cause here, so we don't define it, that's why it's in quotation marks, or Y causes X, or there's a hidden common cause, or a combination of the above. Okay, so this is a common cause principle, and somehow this contradicts this thing, right? Because maybe there's no direct causation, but when there's some dependence, we can already infer something at least about the underlying causal structure. Any comments on this? So there's a possibility that is often left out, that's also possible, that appears often in practice. This is sort of a fourth possibility even, that is sometimes called selection bias. So what is this? So this is yet another explanation for such a dependence. It's not super important, but I think it's nice to have seen it once. So imagine you have three random variables, X, Y, Z, and X is whether you like Spain or not, Y is whether you like machine learning, and Z is whether you attend the machine learning summer school. So now assume that these two things, X and Y, are totally independent, which maybe as a first order approximation they are. So now, when it's sort of X and Y are independent, but now what happens if your condition on Z, and this corresponds to if I now would make a poll, so if I would ask only you people whether you like Spain and whether you like machine learning, then suddenly these two variables become dependent. And this is called the selection bias. Where does this come from? Well, intuitively, if I'm asking you, I know you were attending the MLSS, at least I hope you paid your registration fee. So when I'm asking you, and I realize that, well, you really hate Spain very much, then it's pretty likely that you like machine learning, because there must be reason that you are here. And vice versa, if you really don't like machine learning at all, then probably you like Spain, because otherwise you wouldn't be here. This is called a selection bias. So when you're conditioning on a common effect, then suddenly these X and Y become dependent, which is sometimes a bit counterintuitive. But in studies, it's super important. So, because you often condition on a subgroup of the population. Yes, the question.
Where does the chocolate example fit?
The what example?
The chocolate example, which we start.
What do you think?
Like, I'm trying to think it's a common cause, but it's a very, very distant one.
Yes, I agree. I would say the same thing. So the question is, how does the chocolate example fit? And so the possible explanation is that there's a common cause, so it's this one. But you said it's a very distant one. Maybe you would say it's an indirect one. So something that I said yesterday could be an explanation. It's something like the economic strength of the country. Yeah. Good. So this is somehow at least intuitive, one way to sort of read off at least some part of convention from the dependent structure, and we would like to make this a bit more formal. So this is a slide that is not a lot of fun, but hopefully is very intuitive. So we need to have a bit of a language about graphs, and this is something that you may have seen before. So what is a graph? A graph is a collection of nodes and some edges. And we have a lot of terminology that I won't define, because hopefully most of this is intuitive. So of course, what is a parent of X3? Well, it's X4, because X4 is pointing into X3. What else do we have? A descendant, for example. So here, X1 is a descendant of X4, because there's a directed path to X1. Something that is like, what is an immorality? This language is a bit old, I think. Nowadays it doesn't fit anymore too much. So here, this means that if a node, like X1, has two parents which are not married, so this is an immorality, it's also called a V-structure. So here, this combination X2 to X1 and X3 to X1, but there's no direct links to X2 and between X2 and X3, this is sort of called an immorality. I never fully understood this, because imagine X3 is a child of X2 and they're having a common child, this doesn't seem to be very moral either, but anyhow. Okay, so the only concept that is maybe less intuitive is D-separation, and there we have to go through the definition. Who knows about D-separation? Okay, so I apologize, it will now take a bit of 5 minutes, you can close your eyes whatsoever, but we have to go through the definition. So D-separation will be a concept that only depends on graphs. So this is super important now. We are not talking about joint distributions, we are only talking about graphs. Okay, and D-separation is now a graphical criterion. So I tend to not write down the formal definition here, but we will do an example. So this is the statement that we need to define. Two nodes, xi and xj, are deseparated by a set S. And this is the case if all paths between xi and xj are blocked by S. Okay? So how do you check this in practice? Well, you check whether all paths are blocked, and now we have to say when is the path blocked and when is it unblocked. And these are the three rules. So here we are looking at a path between the red nodes, between xi and xj. And whenever you find a situation like this, so whenever you have like a node on the path that is green, which means that it's in the sort of conditioning set S, then this path is blocked. Okay, so let's make an example. So let's consider x4 and x1. And we are looking at one path, namely at this one. And now if the set, if the node in the middle, this x3, is in the set S, then this path is blocked. And this is because of the first rule. The second rule is very similar, it's just it also happens if you have two outcoming arrows into, from the green one. So this is like these are the sort of more or less intuitive two intuitive rules. There's one rule that is very strange, and this is the last one. So whenever you have such a what we call a collider on the path, so you have two incoming arrows, and now this node here is black. So this is not in the conditioning set. And none of the descendants of this guy is in the conditioning set, then this path is also blocked. Okay, an example. So if we now consider a path, let's say, again between x4 and x1, but now we consider this path. And this node x5 is not in the conditioning set, then this path is also blocked. Okay, so these are like two incoming arrows. So somehow maybe you can think about information flowing. So somehow the information, like there's no shared information between x4 and x1 that goes via this path. There's sort of no direction. Okay, let's make examples. So this is always a statement, and we now always have to decide whether this statement is correct or false, and I don't remember this either, so I have to think myself, so let's try to do it together. So here, x2 and x5 are deseparated by x1 and x4. Is this correct or not? So now what do we have to check? So the first one we are doing together. So we are going through all paths, and then we always check whether the path is blocked. So let's do this path first. Okay, so we go from x2 to x1 and then to x5. Is this path blocked?
Yes.
Yes, because of rule?
One.
Because of rule one, very good. So now we are going through this path here. Okay, so is this path blocked? It's yes, and this is because of the rule number two. So because you only have to find one reason to block a path, and this is a reason here, because this guy, so this x4 is exactly this example here, right? So it has, on the path, there are two outgoing edges, and this is in the conditioning set. So this is the other path, this is also blocked, therefore all paths are blocked, and therefore indeed x2 and x5 are deseparated by x1 and x4. Yeah. Is it a directed graph?
Yeah.
Yes, it's a directed graph. So the D stands for directed, I think, in D separation. A very good point. So I was sloppy in the definition. So the comment is whether this is a path or not. And so you only consider, it is indeed a path. I wasn't explicit here. You always consider paths without considering the directions. No. Okay, second statement. X4 and X1 are deseparated by X2 and X3. Okay, let's make a poll here. So who thinks this is... Okay, I give you 10 more seconds. Who thinks this is correct? Who thinks this is incorrect? And who doesn't care? It's also valid, I think, but you have to go through this. So it's indeed correct, because you go through all possible paths, and this is the first path. This is blocked because of rule one, and then you go through the through this path, and this is also blocked because of rule number three. Okay, one more, and then we stop. X2 and X4 are deseparated by the empty set.
What can you consider X2? Like X2 and X3 blocked.
Ah, you don't, yeah, so why do you consider X2? You don't have to. It's even blocked if you only include X3, that's correct, yeah. Yeah, it's not a minimal set or something.
But it's not blocked because of X5. You mentioned in the last example, X5 is blocking X4 and
X5. Yeah, this is the last case. This is always a bit funny, right? So it's blocked because X5 is not in the set S. So, I mean, this path here is blocked because of this rule. So whenever you have two incoming arrow into an edge, two incoming edges into a node that is not in the set S, then this path is blocked. The last example, this is boring, so this is the same thing. So here again, the statement is true because we have these V's, these colliders again, right? So this path here is blocked because of X1, and this path is blocked because of X5. It's the same thing, it's applying the rule number 3. So last example, okay, we have three yes answers. So X4 and X1 are not separated by X3 and X5. Is this correct or wrong? Okay, who thinks this is a correct statement? Who thinks it's incorrect? And here, very good democracy. So here again, the majority is correct. So this statement is correct because this path here is not blocked. There's no rule that you can apply that blocks this path between X4 and X1. Okay, very good. So take home message, maybe this is a bit like confusing, but so what's really important here to remember is that this is a concept that sort of you can check if you only have the graph. This is a graphical criterion, okay? And it's an important one. So, I mean, the slides are online, you can also check this in the internet if you like, but this is a concept that is quite useful, I think, that you work with the graphs. Yeah?
Sure, in this one, so the X3 is blocked because of the last sentence for the first rule.
So, this path here is blocked, right? That's correct. But you have to check whether all paths are blocked. So one path is blocked. This one is blocked because of rule number one. But what about this path? No, because this, okay, I mean it's lovely and maybe, but this is only blocked if this node is not in the set S. That's why it's black and not green. But this guy is green, right? In this set. Good. So this is the graph. Yeah, one more step. Yes, so it's even, that's why I didn't write definition. So here, the rule is really that not even a descendant of this guy is in the set S. Yeah, that's important. Good, so what do we do with this? We will now, this is sort of the first thing that we see that relates now a distribution and a graph. And this is something that is also known as a Bayesian network. So this is now a definition. So P, we say a distribution P is Markov with respect to a graph if, and now we have two different criteria. One is graphical and one is about the probability distribution. So whenever we have this statement, so this is a graphical criterion, when xi and xj are deseparated by a set S, then this implies that xi and xj are independent conditionally on S. Okay? So this is a graphical criterion, this is a criterion about the distribution. And now this is the first thing that, at least we see in our talk, that relates a distribution and a graph. Yeah?
Unless xi and xj are directly connected, would it always be possible to deseparate them with the rules that we had?
Okay, so the question is, if xi and xj are not directly directed, is it always possible to find the S? And the answer is yes. It's a good point, yeah. So whenever, you know, and this is, could already be useful for causal discovery, you know? Because whenever you see that you can sort of, there is a subset S, so you're given the joint distribution and you find that there is a subset S such that these things are conditionally independent. That these are conditionally independent, yes. So then the question is, can we somehow make a statement about sort of whether they are connected or not? And we will see this later. Okay, so this is the Markov condition, and now, so maybe if you like riddles in a way, there's a small proposition that is not super important for later on, but I say it nevertheless. This is a formalization now of the Reichenbach's common cause principle. So whenever you know that the distribution is marked off with respect to a causal graph G, then Reichenbach's common cause principle is satisfied. And why is this? So what was Reichenbach's common cause principle? It said whenever you have two dependent variables, there's a causal explanation for this, right? And if you use the definition of Markov, this is exactly the same thing here. So when we know that, I write this down maybe. When we know that two variables are dependent, given the empty set, then by the definition of Markovian, this means that they must be, they cannot be deseparated by the empty set, okay? So here we know xi and xj are dependent. This implies that xi and xj are not deseparated, right? And now you are looking for explanations why two nodes are not deseparated. And one explanation is this one, right? So whenever you have a path like this, then they are not deseparated. This is an unblocked path. Another explanation would be this one, right? So if you have maybe something like this, and this is the common cause, right? And this is now the tricky one. You even have this, the fourth thing that I added, you can even have a situation like this. So when you condition on a variable A, then suddenly this path is also unblocked. So this was sort of the fourth explanation. So in a way, not super important, but in a way, this is really a formalization now of the Reichenbach's common cause principle. Okay, but we want to go more in the direction of causal discovery, and there was already a comment about this, so somehow now we can make, if we know something about the independent structure, we can infer something about the graph structure. And there's something else that we need, because now we only have this in one direction, but we would like to have a one-to-one correspondence. And what do you do? If you're a mathematician, you don't care, you just introduce another assumption that exactly assumes the other direction here. Okay? And this is sometimes called the faithfulness assumption. So this states whenever you have a conditional independence, then you also have a deseparation. This assumption here, most people are happy with. Because this is, as I explained, this is more or less the Reichenbach's common cause principle that most people sort of agree on. This assumption is much more debatable. So whether this is a good one or not, and I don't discuss this here, but if you like, you can think about violations of this assumption. But sort of the first idea for causal discovery that I would like to discuss is really making these two assumptions, and now you can imagine what happens. So now we have the one-to-one correspondence between these separations in the graph and conditional dependencies. So what do you do for causal discovery? You're given a joint distribution and you're wondering what is the underlying causal graph. So what do you do? Yeah?
And
we the suggestion was we start with a full graph and remove edges one by one. This is even more complicated, it's correct, but it's even more complicated what I thought of. So the first step is really we are starting with a joint distribution and we are checking for conditional dependencies, right? So we go through all possible conditional dependencies, we write them down as a list, and then you know by these two assumptions that these are exactly the deseparations that must hold. And then you're sort of trying to find the graph that satisfies these deseparation statements. So let's make an example. So imagine I'm telling you, so I'm an oracle now, and I'm telling you, you have three variables. Oh, this is not an oracle, this you know. But the oracle tells you what are the conditional dependencies. So maybe the oracle tells you the only conditional independence that you find is x is independent of y. That's the only thing. And now the question is, if you assume Markov and faithfulness, what is the corresponding graph? So we are now looking for like a graph that satisfies, so this means, this implies that we only have, so let's make this correct, the only conditional independence is this guy. This implies that the only deseparation that you find is x is deseparated by y. Right? And now we are trying to find a graph that has only this deseparation. So what is the corresponding graph between x, y, and z? You can show it the pen. Yes, the V, very good. It's this one. That's the only graph that satisfies the this sort of requirement that there's only one D separation. Right? Why is this the case? So are X and Y D separated? Yes, because here this path is blocked, right? This guy is not in the conditioning set, and this is the only D separation that we find. Let's try this. So what about this guy here? Are X and Y D separated? No. And also you have another one. So you have here, you have X is D separated from Y given Z. Right? So this is, I mean, you can check out on a piece of paper, but this is really the only graph that satisfies this requirement. And this is sort of the flavor of the first idea. So you go through all possible conditional dependencies, and then you check the graphs that satisfy this D separation. And this is sort of just a sort of a comic out of this. So I just finish this, and then, so here we start with the joint distribution. We list all conditional independencies, so possibly by an independence test. And by Faithful and Markov, we know that there's, like, we list all the graphs that correspond to these D separations.
What if we remove an edge?
If you remove an edge?
Yeah, like X and Z, just there's no...
Aha! Okay, so you're talking about this example. So here, what happens? You get a different D separation. So X and Y are still D separated, but additionally, X is D separated from Z now. And this is why you assume, I mean, the assumed Markov and faithfulness, which means there's a one-to-one correspondence between independencies and these separations. So all these separations must be independencies and vice versa. So even, so this is not possible either. So it's really, believe me, it's really this graph that's the only graph satisfying. Okay. Yeah.
But you said that graph is separated and it implies independence.
Okay, so this graph is separated, I hopefully didn't say. So here X and Y are deseparated in the graph, right?
So if you condition in S, X and Y become dependent, but here you want independence.
No, no, so here, so what happened? Okay, I mean, you have two lists, right? So here, these are the lists of conditioning dependencies in P. Here this is a property about P, and here these are properties about the graph, right? So now we list all conditionally independencies, and this is the only one. So you have that, for example, X is dependent of Y given Z, right? Because I said this is the only independence. So here you have a dependence. And here in this graph, the only D separation that you find is this one. You have that X is deseparated, not deseparated, from Y given Z, right? And this statement corresponds to this dependence. So it's all correct, I think. So it's really a one-to-one correspondence between the independencies and the deseparation statements. And if you condition on Z, here you get a not a deseparation, it's deconnected, and here you get a dependence. Yes?
To connect to the statement, it's simply S is empty.
Yes. Here, S is empty, yeah. Okay, I mean, we did this here by hand, and we had to discuss a lot. So the question is there any sort of algorithmic way to do this? And the answer is yes, which is especially important in situations like this one. So if you look at the example, maybe someone sees it directly. So this is not the only graph that satisfies this sort of list of dependencies or independencies or corresponding D separations. Sometimes, and this happens in most cases, you have more than one graph that is possible. And then it's especially important to have an algorithm that sort of lists all the possible graphs. And so sort of these are, you don't have to remember the details, but these are the names. So Perl invented the IC algorithm, or Peter Sturz and Clark Rimmer the PC. The FCI is a different algorithm. These are sort of from the flavor, it's really find all conditional dependencies and then select the bags that correspond to these dependencies. And here, for example, you have like possibly more than one graph that comes out of this. Okay, so if you are a computer scientist, you should be worried about this statement here. finding all permission dependencies, if you have 10 variables, these are a lot, right? So we have to be a bit more clever. But one example, I skipped this, I think. So this is a myopia example. You can go through this. So it turns out that there's also confounder, and this is a method that you can apply. But here, what I said, so you don't want to find all, go through all the possible independencies, and small examples like myopia or here, you can do this. But in larger examples, you don't want to do this, so I just wrote be smart here. And these methods are really neat in the sense, so they are quite efficient. Yeah. And this goes in the direction what you said, so you want to start, you want to remove edges, for example. So you want to have some sort of greedy technique that is hopefully still correct. Okay, so far about independence-based methods. That's the first idea. So here, really connect the deseparations to the conditional independencies and then go through all the graphs. Any questions about this? Yeah?
There's the sixth possibility of the five possibilities that it's just random dependencies. The data, the way we settle it, by random chance, cannot be random.
Okay, so the question is, what about, I mean, an oracle can tell you exact independence and dependence, but if you have data, so what do you do? And this is a very good point, because so what people do in practice, this is now a bit subtle, but hopefully understandable. So what people do in practice is they perform condition dependence tests. So now two comments about this. One, this is a super difficult problem. So I've also tried to work on this a bit. If, like condition dependencies, especially if you condition on more than, let's say, three random variables, it's super difficult. So you can imagine it's even more difficult than regression. So regression is like a simple subproblem of finding a conditional independence. So therefore, you have to be careful. What people do in practice, often they just use partial correlation, which considers the linear case. So this is something that that one has to bear in mind, that this is a difficult problem, statistical problem. So you need an enormous amount of data to get reliable outcomes of the tests. The other one, it's sort of, and I think there's really a problem in the nature of these methods. If you do a statistical test, then by definition, this is asymmetric, right? So whenever you reject the null hypothesis, this is the case when you are certain about your result, and when you don't reject it, you're not certain. So you have an asymmetry in finding dependencies and finding independencies, right? So this is the usual property of statistical tests, that you can bound one of the two errors but not both at the same time. Here somehow, it's a bit weird because we are making use both of the independencies and the independencies, the dependencies and the independencies. And therefore, it's a bit funny that we are treating them in an asymmetric way. And this is maybe not a direct answer to your question, but this is like it pointing in the same direction. There's a huge problem in finite data. And this is also why you see that these methods, so sometimes they output a list of independencies that are inconsistent, where you know there's no graph that satisfies each independencies. And this is in a way good because then you know something is fishy here. So something is going wrong. But you have to be very careful if you're using sort of these methods. But I mean, for example, what we see in practice is that the skeleton often is rather reliable. There is a lot of the directions you have to be a bit careful with. And this is exactly the problem. Good. Any other questions about these methods? But hopefully it shows some of the ideas that you can try to exploit to get the identifiability. Yeah?
Imagine that we also need huge data, amount of data to perform these tests. Why? Because of noise? Or?
Okay, so I mean, one reason is that these conditional dependence tests are just difficult. So you imagine you want to estimate a function. Imagine you have a completely non-parametric regression problem. So you have the variable integer that is y, and you're regressing it on four variables, and this function can depend arbitrarily on these four variables. Then I would say you need a lot of data in order to get a reliable estimate of this function. And so in the independence test, it's sort of, I mean, you have to be able to solve this regression as well. Because imagine that both like x2 and x3 depend in a very complicated way on, let's say, four other variables. And you want to see whether there's, I mean, this you want to regress out. This is sort of common way you want to regress out. And you want to see, is there some dependence left if I regress out, like x, these other four variables. This is a subproblem. You have to be able to solve this. So, and this is just statistically hard. It's a curve of dimensionality, right? So the dependence, if you, you can always check like what's the rate of the error going down, and this depends on the dimension of the problem. This is one thing, and the other one is you have to be correct somehow this collection of dependents and independent statements. Even this has to be correct, right? So this is subtle because you're making inference out of the combination of these sort of statements. So in a way, all of them have to be correct. And just in practice, if you do simulations, you need a lot of data before you see them, before you really get all the edges correct.
What's the test for the single pair of variables?
This is a very good point. So this is on my next slide, I think. So the question is, what happens if you only have two random variables? Or do you mean when the conditioning set is empty?
No, just like for single, I'm interested in a single pair, even if there is more.
If you only have two random variables?
No, not necessarily.
So if this is, if you want to test a statement like this, x1
yes.
independent of x2. There are tons of independence tests. So one way is to say, if you assume that everything is Gaussian, then you just test for correlation, right? Then you do a Z-transform, you get a test. If you want to do a non-parametric independence test, so what we do a lot in practice is a kernel-based test. Maybe Arthur Gresham talked about this H-SIG, Hilbert-Schmidt independence criterion. This is something that we use that we find works reasonably reliable in practice. The problem, in my opinion, is really if you start conditioning on variables, then it becomes much more difficult. Okay, but one important question is, what happens, or this is maybe not an important question, but then one that leads to the next idea is, what happens if you only have two random variables? So somehow, imagine two random variables that are dependent on each other. So what happens then? So this is again our world in G, and this is our world in G. And I'm telling you, you have two random variables x and y, and you don't find any independence. So you just have x is dependent on y. So what is the corresponding graph? So here we have x is not de-separated from y. What is the corresponding graph? Two nodes, and they are connected, right? Can either be this one or this one, you don't know. And this is a bit unfortunate. So this means that these methods can never say anything if you have only two random variables. So somehow they exploit conditioning dependencies, and these you don't find in the bivariate case. So this sort of leads to the second idea that I would like to discuss. So this goes in a different direction, but also tries to cover these cases here. Do we make a small break now? Yes? Okay, so we do a small 5 minute break. Let's meet at 10 past. Yes, this could be the case. So then you assume hidden variables. So if you don't assume hidden variables, if you assume x and y are all random variables, then these are the only graphs that you can have. Yeah, it's a good point, yeah. There are methods trying to account for this. So then, what the methods do, like FCI is one of those methods, they would say it's either x for the y or y for the x, or there's a confounder. But you can't say more than
this. But no one knows the results. Apparently, these two teams have 12 problems. But which one of them will be the first one? The winner? It's yet to know.
It's still like freezing or frozen.
Well, the standings will be frozen until the very end. Yeah, to the same. But some people might have manually calculated the timeline. So
40 minutes or so, I would like to discuss two more ideas, and I really appreciate if you're also critical with these ideas. I mean, just put this in perspective. This is now really a difficult problem. We are trying to learn something about the causal structure from the like underlying distribution. It's a super difficult problem, and you often also meet people, statisticians at conferences who say, well, that's just not possible. So this is like current research, and we are at the moment exploiting these assumptions. There's a huge space of assumptions, and see under which assumptions can we make some inference about the cause structure. I think it's an interesting and important problem in practice, because often, as we discussed yesterday, we cannot do the randomized experiments, but you also have to be aware that it's a difficult problem. And right now, at least that's my point of view, but maybe it's biased, I have the impression that more and more people in statistics and machine learning are getting interested in this field, because we are seeing now some success stories of these methods. But therefore, because it's at the edge, it's not established, you should really remain critical about these assumptions. Okay, so the second idea, this is the question about two variables. So what we do, we would like to also make a statement in this case, and here what I showed is a collection of data sets that we gathered over some years at the MPI in Tübingen. It's probably very hard to see, but now this is, I don't even know, something like 80 or so data sets, and these are always two variables, X and Y. These are real data sets, something like, I don't know, availability of clean drinking water and child mortality rate. And so the point is, can you develop methods that can infer whether X is causing Y or Y is causing X? Okay, and these data sets are collected such that we hope that there's not a strong influence of a confounder, so it really is X causing Y or Y causing X. This is available for download, so if you come up with a new method, just try it out. What I would like to point you at is this example here. So you have a random variable X and Y, and this is the scatter plot, and now I would like you to guess, these are all randomly oriented, so whether you think that X is the cause or Y is the cause. So look at this example here. Okay, so who thinks that X is the cause of Y? Who thinks that Y is the cause of X? Aha, very good. So we are infinitely more people believe that X is the cause of Y, which is indeed the case. So here, this is something like day of the year, I think. So if you like, the position of the Earth, and this is the temperature. And indeed, X is the cause of Y, and somehow, I mean, what is now the reason why we intuitively believe that X is the cause of Y? Somehow, I mean, one possibility to phrase this is that this function here looks much easier in one direction than the other. And there seems to be an asymmetry that we would like to exploit now. So this is again a structural equation model that you have seen, and mathematically you can now ask, well, if we are just given the distribution over x1 to x4, can we recover the directed acyclic graph? So for the abbreviation. So can we recover the graph from the distribution? And the answer in general is no. So I don't state the theory in here, but this is very easy to see. In general, that's not possible. But now the hope is that if we have these simple functions, and the example before was pointing at this, maybe then you can do something, and indeed this is the case. So here, if you assume, for example, that the noise acts in an additive way, so if this is not a general function like this, but if the noise acts in an additive way, then, for example, you can prove that indeed the graph can be recovered from the joint distribution. There's a small subtlety here, so you really have to exclude the linear Gaussian case. It's a bit funny situation, because often we like linear Gaussian cases, and identifiability we don't. So as long as the data is not linear Gaussian, you can indeed infer the graph structure from the joint distribution. Okay, and here I would like to give you a bit of an intuition. So what is the statement in the two variable case? So let's say this is a one structural equation model, so here Y is really a function of X plus some independent noise, and the other one is X is a function of Y plus some independent noise, and the statement is, if this model holds true, this model cannot hold true. Okay, that's the identifiability statement for two variables. And I would like to give a sort of an intuitive understanding for this that also hints at what you could do in practice. So this is now an example. I just plug in a nonlinear function, x to the 3, and I give you some noise distributions, and now we can plot everything. So this is now a full description of a structural equation model, and I can plot this graph. I can plot the joint distribution. How do I do this? So this is the x values, this is the y values, this is my function x to the 3, and now I just sample. So here I sample from x, according to Gaussian, I plug it through the function, and then I add some Gaussian noise here. Okay, this is the scatter plot. So this is the end. Good. Now comes the 10 euros question. So why can we not write this as a model in the opposite direction? So why can we not write x as a function of y plus an infinite amount? Yeah. Ah, very good. It would be heteroscedastic. So here, I mean, now the question is, why can we not invert the model? So in a way, you can turn your head and look at it the other way around, right? So then x suddenly is a function of y. So this looks fine. I mean, in practice, you can just fit the function. This is what I did here. So now you fit x as a function of y, and you have some noise. So this all seems fine. What's the problem? The problem is indeed the heteroscedasticity. So here, if you tilt your head, then what you see is that in some areas, suddenly the noise has a much, much higher variance than in other areas. So here the variance of the noise is much smaller than here, for example. And if you plot the residuals, this is exactly what you see. So in this area you get many more residuals, many larger, a much larger variance of the residuals than here. So this is the sort of intuitive reason for this. Questions? Yeah. Very good question. So what happens if you have multiplicative noise? So two answers to this. One is you can extend this model a bit. So you can apply a nonlinearity afterwards as well. So you can work with logarithms and exponentials. So where you say y is not a function of x plus some noise, but y is a function of x plus some noise, and then you apply nonlinearity. So this leads to a wider model class. The second question is, well, what happens if we have a weird combination of multiplicative noise and nonlinearity, and then it just looks like such an what we call additive noise model in one direction, but indeed it's the wrong direction. You can prove, but I don't go in, I'm afraid I don't have time for this, I'm going to lead us, but you can prove that this is in a way very unlikely. So you can only do this if you really fine-tune this relation between like influence of the noise and the sort of function. And this you can consider as being unlikely. Okay, so here I think I will skip a couple of details because I would like to spend a bit more time on the third idea. But here the point or the take-home message, I go back a few slides, is really that the identifiability comes from simplifying the functions. So whenever you assume you have a model class that you like, a simple model class, then this often leads to identifiability. And this is a bit funny, I think, because somehow, I mean, we like simple classes anyway, because we can learn them, right? If you want to, there's no free lunch. So if you want to perform a regression, and the regression function is arbitrarily complex, you cannot learn it anyhow. So therefore, you also have these simplicity ideas, but they come from a very different direction, I would say, from statistical learning theory. And here, we have the sort of very similar simplicity ideas, but now they don't only help us to learn the function, they also, we also gain something in terms of identifiability. Okay, and now you can ask, well, is this a reasonable assumption or not, right? So, what about this additive noise assumption? Do we see this in practice or not? And one answer to this would be, well, there's one advantage, you can always test for this, right? And if you don't see this in reality, at least you can say, well, okay, I made an assumption, it seems to be violated, so I don't say anything. I said, this method cannot do anything, so I have to try something else. So at least you can test for these assumptions. There was a question.
Yeah, I'm not sure if that's but you have the intuition that the functions are indeed more complicated. You cannot use kernels or something like that.
So you want to relax this assumption and put a, like, you want to work with this, but now directly penalize the complexity of the function f? Yeah, this is a good point. You can, you're more than happy to try. I think no one has done it. I mean, there's a, something slightly related where someone tried this. I can show you the reference, but there's some of the latent theory. But if you would have a theory for this, this would be, I think, amazing. Because this would, in a way, this is a hard constraint, right? So it says it's really additive. And then we have some theory. But what would be nice is to say, well, the more simple this function becomes, then the more identifiability gain. And this is just one way of a simple function, right? One example. Yeah, so this would be great. Okay, What do I do? So maybe, you know, this is a graph that is maybe interesting to see, in the sense that here what we do now is we perform the this sort of methodology on the real data sets that we have, these 80 pairs or something, and what you see is, so you should look at the red line, this is additive noise. What you see is here on the y-axis the accuracy, how many of the decisions are correct, and on the x-axis you see how many decisions to be made. So if we have to decide in all pairs, then we are correct in what, like 70% or so. The gray area is the area that is not significant. So here we are just slightly above significance, and then if you decrease the decision rate, which means you allow the method to only make a decision when it's pretty certain, then you see that this curve goes up, which is, I think, a good thing. So this is not a proof, but at least it's an indication that there seems to be some signal in the simplicity of the function, right? It's not a perfect method. It doesn't always make the right decision, but it seems that it's pretty much significantly better than random guessing.
Sorry. You chose the 8 examples just randomly?
Ah, so this is, okay, I mean, there you have to leave me because indeed we collected data sets, but we were trying very hard to not like make any other, to only decide whether to include this pair or not if the causality is more or less clear. You have a lot of situations where the causality is not clear and then you don't want to include this. But this was the only way. So something else that we made sure is whenever someone proposed a pair, all of us, I think we were 5 or so, had to say whether they believe that X is causing Y or Y is causing X, and only if all of us agreed, we included the data set. But it's not perfect, but at least it's something, it's real data and it's not simulated data. On simulations, of course, everything works, which just means you didn't do a mistake in your theory, hopefully. Okay, so maybe skip the data. So the data for so this data for chocolate is very noisy, it's very bad quality data. I looked at the paper, it's even from different years and so on, very different sources, but you have the same idea for coffee. So here if you look at the data for coffee and Nobel Prizes, this is also a strong dependence here. So these are again different countries, it's not as nice because I didn't include the flags, but you have a bit more data points. Coffee consumption per year per person, and Nobel Prizes per 10 million. Very strong correlation. So what happens if you now apply the method? So here you can try to sort of fit the model from coffee to Nobel Prizes and from Nobel Prizes to coffee. And this is sort of an indication how well does the model fit. And what you see here is that in both directions the fit is terrible. So the p-value of independence of residuals is here 10 to minus 78, and here 10 to minus 12. So in both directions it's terrible. And this is what I was indicating before. So in these situations, the method would say, I don't know. It's really not an additive noise model, right? And here, it's sort of, I think it's a good thing because either, so this means that either the model class is too small, so maybe the noise is not additive, or the data set is what we call causally insufficient, so there are other variables that are important, but that, it's not, that are not measured. And here, I guess this is the case, something like economic strength. So this is as a toy example of how would you would use these methods. So you really check, I mean, if you find a very good model fit in one direction and a bad model fit in the other, then maybe you go for one direction, but otherwise you don't. Okay, so I would like to skip this. This may be something you can remember. So somehow this is the empire of additive noise models, and you have this tiny village that is not identifiable, and that's the linear Gaussian case. Okay, that's sort of the bad case. In almost all other situations, you can identify the causal structure. Good. This is something about theory, how you could fit these methods that I don't talk about. This is something that you also have to keep in mind when you work in causality. So somehow, the question is now, like, if you have more than two variables, how do you find a very good model? And what you see here is now, depending on the number of variables, you find the number of graphs. Okay, so let's see whether this makes sense. If you have two nodes, they are three directed acyclic graphs. Is this correct? I think yes, because you have an empty graph, like x causing y and y causing x, makes three different graphs. What about three nodes? Why is it 25? Anyone see this? So you can start counting or you count backwards. So in total there are 27 graphs because you can either include an edge in one direction, the other direction, or empty. So you have three edges, which makes 3 to the 3 edges a possibility of graphs, right? This is 27, and you have two cycles, two combinations making a cycle, so there are 25. So this is great. Four graphs that I think we don't count here, but this is the number of decks that you find. What I like about this graph is, I mean, these are not just big numbers. What you see is that the length of the number is increasing more than linear, which means that the numbers, so the amount of graphs is increasing more than exponential, right? So these are, this is really a problem in practice because you don't may want to apply this method for more than 20 variables, right? And this is something we have to deal with in reality. So how do you, under all these models, how do you find the graphs that, that lead to the best fit? And so there you can apply greedy algorithms, for example. Yeah?
Can you repeat why do we subtract the two cycles?
Okay, this is just a comment about why there are there 25 directed acyclic graphs for three nodes. So you have three edges in the graph. Each edge can be either in one direction or in the other direction or empty, which makes three possibilities. Three edges, it's 3 to the 3. And then you have to subtract the graphs that are cyclic. But there are only two graphs that are cyclic. One goes like this, and one goes like this.
So this is always assumptions that we...
Yeah, so here, I mean, you can relax this, but here I always talk about situations without cycles. Good. Any questions about these restricted structured equation models? So they make model assumptions.
What's your opinion on this? Is that the problem
empty? You can even... this is a bit tricky. There are instances of this problem... Okay, so I mean, what do we do, what shall we do? You have to be aware of this, and you can use greedy search techniques. And usually, so this works very well in practice. So one reason for this is there are lots of details. One reason for this is if you look at a graph and you want to compute something like the score of the graph, then the score decomposes over the nodes. So if you are changing, for example, you are scoring this, you compute a likelihood, for example, for this graph structure, and then you have a greedy algorithm, because you cannot do it exhaustively, you have a greedy algorithm, so you're wondering, what happens if I include this edge here? So then, the nice thing is, you only have to the score decomposes over the nodes, and you only have to recompute the score that corresponds to this node. So that's sort of nice, yeah. And this is a... something to be aware of that you probably should do greedy search methods. There was another question, I think. Yeah?
So, this number is the number of structures that we have in nodes. Would we have for you the some constraints in the integrating?
Yeah, this helps. Yeah. So, the question is can we also, this is another direction that you can try to look at. So, can you also make the problem easier by bounding the integrity of the nodes. And yes, you can, yeah. There's also something to do. Good. So for the remaining time, what I would like to do, how many more minutes do I have? Until like 30 minutes, right? Okay, so I skipped a few things here. So the last 20 minutes, I would like to talk about a third idea. And if you did like the first 2 months, that's the last chance for me at least. That I personally am a big fan of at the moment, and this is something that we call invariant fault prediction. So what's the idea here? So this picture you have seen before, and I told you that often in problem discovery, we are interested in what happens if you have a distribution P and you're trying to find the causal structure. So in this third idea, what we are exploiting is we are seeing the data in what we call different environments. So in a way, this is this problem that we're considering. So here, we are seeing the distribution P, but we are also seeing some interventional distributions or environment distributions Q, and we are wondering, can we make something, can we infer something about the causal structure? Okay, let me try to explain it. So here, the problem that we are discussing, we make it a tiny bit easier, so we are not trying to show the whole causal structure, but we have a target variable y, and now we are trying to find the causal parents of this target variable y. Okay? So we are interested in parts of the structure. And then what will be, I think, nice is that we will get very naturally to confidence statements. Okay, so that's sort of the picture that hopefully tells you something about the idea. So here we have a target variable y, and maybe that's the causal graph, and we receive data from this joint distribution. And then, so this is maybe our distribution P, we also get some data from a somewhat interventional distribution that we don't really have details about, we just know it's a different distribution that may look like this. So here, these hammers indicate that something changed in the graph. Okay, so that's sort of the situation. And now, what happens is, we receive this as a like pooled data set, right? So we know we have 500 data points here, blue data points and 500 data points, red data points. And the question is, we don't know the causal graphs, and we are wondering, can we somehow infer the causal parents of y? Sorry, so here the ground truth is x3, right? This is the only causal parent of y. So now, how would you do this? So the first idea is to say, well, just pool the data and do a linear regression, right? So you're pooling the data, you're pooling these two data sets, and just look, well, maybe we regress y on the other x variable. And this is what happens. So this is the pool data set. So this is the paired scatter plot. And now what we do is, in R, for example, you just run a linear model from Y on X, and then you look at the results. And this is what you get. All of the variables are highly significant. And this is, intuitive in the sense that, so here, this is nothing is causal about this method, right? You're just asking, what are good predictors for y? Everything is a good predictor for y, but there's nothing causal about this. So here, they go back in the slides, we are somehow interested in x3 because this is the cause of y, so when we intervene on x3, then really y changes. But if you just ask, well, which variables are good for predicting y, then you get end up with all variables. Okay? And here's sort of the method that we are proposing, and I will tell you a bit more details about how it works. So what happens is, you just plug in the data as before, so x and y, but you also indicate the index of the experiment. So you say the first 500 data points are experiment 1, the last 500 are experiment 2. That's all what you need to know. You're not like plugging in more information than this. And this is what comes out of it. So it looks like the outcome of a regression model, but now suddenly you only have variable 3 that is significant. So here you say, well, variable 3 really seems to be a causal variable. And in the remaining time, I would like to sort of explain what this method is doing. But this is how there's code available. This is exactly what you do. So you have a target variable y, you have some predictor variables x, and you just input the index of the experiment. Okay, so here's the intuition. So this is a picture that you have seen tons of times now. This is our structure equation model, and this is now the key idea, and it's really trivial. That's what I like about it. So we have seen this yesterday as well in an example. So this, if you have a target variable y, and now imagine that you intervene somewhere in the graph except for y, right? So you're allowed to intervene anywhere in the graph. Doesn't matter, even at several nodes at the same time. The key observation is now that this structural equation model here, this structural equation for y, this never changes, right? So you're intervening somewhere, but this structural equation doesn't change, which means that this conditional doesn't change. So the conditional of y given x1, or in general, y given the parents of y, this is always the same, no matter where you intervene. This is trivial, right? And why is this? Well, if you intervene on x1, then you're changing this structural equation. The blue one remains the same. If you're intervening here, if this can be a complex intervention, again, the blue one remains the same. You can intervene at all places at the same time, the blue one remains the same. That's sort of the key idea. And this is this is a typo here. So this is now the sort of the main assumption that we do. So we are saying, there's a mess up with the LaTeX, I'm sorry. So let us start with the indices of the parents, and now this is the main assumption. So somehow the x's may have an arbitrary distribution, but the point is that, don't know what happened. So the point is that this conditional here, y given x s star, this is always the same conditional. So this remains invariant. Okay, and now you can look at this in a linear model, but that's not super important. And here, look at this, these three lines. So the goal is to find the set S star, right? And what we have is we have data from different environments. Let's call them E and E. And so we try to find this set S star. And what we do is we always, for each candidate set S now, we always check whether we find this invariant prediction or not. Okay, so this is what we are doing. So we have a candidate set S, and now we check if we regress Y on this candidate set S. Do we always find the same prediction, the same model or not? That's sort of the key idea. And now, so we know that for the parents, as I argued on the last slide, for the parents we know this is true, right? If you regress on the parents, in all the environments, you will have exactly the same conditional. It's exactly the same model. So you can think of running a linear regression in the first environment and in the second, and just checking whether the regression coefficients are the same or not. And we know for the parents it's the case. So now we don't know the parents, but now what we do is we just go through candidate set S. We always check, okay, we take this candidate set S, you check, is it satisfied or not, that you always get the same regression coefficient. We're almost done. We have one problem. What happens if this is satisfied for more than one set? So we know that this is true for the correct set, but what happens if it's true for more than one? And this is on this slide. And that's the last slide that we have to understand, and then we're done. Yeah, you can take the smallest. You can also do something else. we will do the intersection, but this idea of making it small is a good idea. Okay, so here in practice, so this is the null hypothesis, if you like, of invariant prediction. So we are using a candidate set S. We have our data in different environments, and we check, do we have the same model in each environment? Okay, so this can either be rejected or not rejected. And now this is what we are doing is, if you have more than one candidate set S, we are taking the intersections. So let's look at an example. So these are the candidate sets S. One of them is the true one, we don't know which one. These are the candidate sets S, and we always check, do we have invariant prediction or not? Yes, no, yes, no, yes. And then what we do is, for all yes answers, we take intersections. So this means we take the variables that appear in all those yes answers. And here it's the variable 3, I think, right? So this is the only variable that appears in the three yes answers. Okay, and now, so this is, you can do something, but you can do this, but now there's one very obvious result that you can derive. You know that this set S star is among those sets, right? This is the true set. You know that this must satisfy invariant prediction, which means that if you now take intersection and one of those sets is the correct set, you only make it smaller. But you are always going to get a set that is a subset of the correct set. And in the final sample statement, this is what what I would like to stress, you get this result. So the estimated set of causal predictors is really a subset of the true set with the large probability. Okay, so let's try to understand this. I mean, what are we doing? We are saying we have data in different environments, and we are trying to find the causes. We know that for the causes, it's true that we always, in all environments, we have the same model. Okay, so somehow, we now like to turn this idea around and say, okay, then we just check, go through several candidate sets S, and always check, do we get the same model in all environments or not? And for all those sets that satisfy this condition, we take an intersection. So then we may get an empty set, or we may get a very small set, like here. But the point is, out of trivial mathematics, you can now show that this set that you get is certainly a subset of the true set S star. And this is the confidence statement. So this means sometimes your method is outputting the empty set, so then you don't know anything. But if it's outputting something, then you can be pretty certain that it's the correct answer. And this is the sort of what we sometimes call a coverage guarantee. Any questions about this? Yeah.
When you are using the AI software, so you are using the vector of 1 and 2, and you have a new number for each new environment,
Yeah. So you can have 10 environments, and then you just provide indices and say the first 200 data points are from environment 1, then we have 250 from environment 2, then we have 400 from environment 3. That's the thing, you don't even have to specify it. So you have only one target that you provide, and that's all what you have to provide. You don't have to provide details about the environments. They can be anything. And in practice, I mean, this is a bit funny in the sense that usually we try very hard to make everything sort of reproducible, right? So if you're a biologist, you're trying to make the data in the same bed from the same person so that everything is IID and very like comparable. In this method, you want to do something very different. So you are gaining something by the heterogeneity of the data. So you just want the data to be from different environments. And what happens is that, why is this so helpful? Because usually what we think is that causal predictors are stable. So the causal predictions are the ones that sort of hold in many different environments. And this method turns this idea around. It says, okay, if you have data from different environments, you're just looking for the state of stuff, and we are saying, well, this is probably causal. And therefore, you don't even have to provide what the environments are. So if you like, you can tell the biologist, well, maybe more, tomorrow you should come drunk to work and try to repeat the experiment or whatever. You need this heterogeneity in the data.
So this
Ah, that's a good point. So I'm not sure whether I understood you, but so it's the question whether it gives an idea of what kind of intervention you would like to do in order to gain identifiability. So we didn't look at this, but this is a very natural question. It's a good question to ask, yeah. And there's some work that is already, it's the question of active learning. So what kind of experiments you would like to do, and there's indeed, I think the question is very relevant. So the question is, you always have to know which data point comes from which environment, and there the answer is surprisingly no. You can even pool environments, you can make them, you can split them, it doesn't matter. And the reason why it doesn't matter is that for the true set S star, this is the true set, you will find invariant prediction no matter how you pool the environments. So you can even guess. So if you have data, you can even guess, oh, probably this from the first environment and this from the second. Yeah, one more question.
So in this case, the environment needs to be not exactly the same.
You even benefit if they're not the same. So
is it possible to exploit, you know, the difference among these?
is it possible to exploit if you know what the difference between the environments are? Also a very good question. So, I mean, basically, we presented this work last week, and my answer is I don't know. Yeah. So, intuitively, it should be the case. Because here, we really throw away a lot of information. Yeah. If you may, I may show one real experiment, and this question becomes very clear. Yeah?
Probably a good question, but what if the environment actually destroys the causal relation, like you block out the gene that's causing the
Very good. So, okay, so wait a second. I need to show one graph somehow. I have graphs here. So let's say this is the target gene, and this is a cause, right? And now what is certainly allowed, and this is depicted here, is if you knock out this gene. That's totally fine if you delete this gene. The problem is you are not allowed to intervene on Y. And so this is all the underlying assumption is you're not intervening in all the environments, you're not intervening on the target variable. So the question, what happens if you do this? You think you're not doing this, but by chance you're doing this. This is also an important question, and in statistics we call this robustness, right? So what happens if your model assumptions are violated? And I think this is a super important problem. It's difficult, so that's why in many theoretical studies, not only for causal inference, also in many other methods, I think it's not studied very well because it's such a difficult problem. But in practice, it's super important. There's this famous quote, all models are wrong and some are useful, that you may have heard before. It's really true in the sense that all models are wrong, so you have to analyze what happens if your model assumptions are violated. And so you can analyze this for this method as well. Intuitively, what will happen is the following. If you intervene on the target gene Y, let's say, then you never find invariant prediction. So you can show that it's very unlikely that any set will lead to this invariant prediction, which means that you are taking an intersection over the empty set. So there's no set included here. And then you output the empty set. Yeah, in this sense, you have a robustness guarantee that if your model assumptions are violated, the method says nothing. And nothing in this case is not wrong. If you allow, I just show maybe some experiments and then we can conclude. So I skip the results. This is about robustness here. So this is the experiment that you have seen before. So here we have 6,000 genes. We have about 160 data points that are wild type. So this blue data points here, observational data, and then we have a lot of these gene deletions. And what we are looking for are these pairs, right? So here, for example, this gene 5954 is causing this gene 547110, because when you delete this gene, the activity goes down, and at the same time, the activity of this gene also goes down. And this is an indication for really a true causal hit. So this is what you're looking for, and these are like 0.1% of the pairs that satisfy this. So random guessing will be very bad, because random guess. And what are our environments? And this goes back to your question. So we are a bit like ignorant about the data. So we are saying we have two environments. One is observational, and one is interventional. And so there we throw away the information where the intervention took place. So this is known, right? So you know where the gene deletions took place. You just throw this away. And then let's say we pick one target gene, let's say it's this one, 47110, and we apply our method and we see, well, does it predict any causal relations or not? And if it does, then we check whether it's a correct one. And this is what you see. So here, these are the sort of predicted pairs. So from 0 to 25, so it's very little, right? So and here you always check whether it's a correct pair or not. And the optimal method would be on this diagonal. So whenever it makes a prediction, it's a correct one. It's an ROC type curve. And what you see is that this is the invariant prediction here. It makes a lot of correct answers. And this is something that we were at least quite happy about. This is the orange one here is a version of this that allows for hidden variables. And the gray area, this is random guessing. So it really seems to be doing something better than just random guessing. Okay, maybe I conclude, and then if you like, we can take a few more minutes for questions. Well, is it directly related to this? Okay, yeah.
So I understand that theoretically you don't need to know where the intervention took place, but in practice, because of noise, can you gain information by knowing where?
Yes, so the question, I think, goes in a similar direction from the question before. So can we gain something if we exploit the information where the intervention took place? And so the answer is, I could guess so, but I don't know for sure. But probably, it feels like it, right? So we are throwing away information. I mean, one way to look at it is to say, well, maybe we are more robust towards off-target, right? So maybe the biologist thinks that it's intervening on this gene, but in fact it's intervening on this gene, but also on 10 other genes. So maybe this method would be robust, but still it feels like we should gain information. Maybe as a side remark, I mean, this yeast, greedy interventionally equivalent search, this is using this information that the intervention took place. So there are methods that try to use this, but at least here it really doesn't do anything useful. Good. So this is the sort of the second version of this joke. I don't know whether you've seen it. I used to think correlation didn't imply causation, then a study showed correlation and causation were correlated, now I do. Sounds like you changing your mind changed the result. Sort of a nice set of references. Good. So this is sort of the summary of the second part from today. So the first idea was these conditional dependencies, right? So you list all the conditional dependencies from the observational distribution, and then by Markov and faithfulness, you relate this to these separations in the graph, and you list them in a clever way. The second one was to impose restrictions on the structural equation model. So here, for example, the additivity. And the third idea was this invariant prediction, the more heterogeneity, the better. So there, this is sort of the picture that I also showed once. So the idea is that for causal predictions, it's always the same in all environments. This environment one, this environment two, and you see it's the same regression coefficient. And you can exploit these sort of stability for a causal instance. Good. Very quickly, there are lots of open questions. Like in all areas, I would say, it's probably everyone says this, and that's true for most fields. Here in the basics, so what is a good definition of problem strength? We briefly discussed yesterday. The restricted structural equation models, do we still have identifiability of causal structures if they are hidden variables? The answer is probably yes, but no one has proved it so far, was able to prove it. Real data, can we solve practically relevant problems? So this is really the stage we are working on right now. So there are more and more people from applied sciences getting interested. And this is something that I think Bernhard maybe mentioned at the Bernhard Schulkopf at the introductory lecture, causality in machine learning. So do causal ideas help for classical tasks in machine learning? Maybe you remember the same supervised learning idea I think we talked about. So this falls into this area, and this is also next. I think an interesting field of research. Maybe a couple of references. So there's a famous book from Pearl, Causality. It's a very nice book, maybe as an introduction, and not super easy to read, but there's a lot of information, a lot of nice ideas in there. Spurter, Slimmer, Shiner, Scottish, British Research. This is not, I don't want to make self-advertisement too much. I tried to write a script, because I thought that there is still room for improvement for getting into the fields. And this was sort of written last year when we gave a lecture at ETH. You're more than welcome to look at this and provide feedback. And with this, thanks a lot for your attention. Yeah, so the question is scalability. So we have seen that the number of graphs explodes, so how many variables can we use in practice? For the independence-based methods, this is why I said one word about this. I said that the PC algorithm is really genius, and it's genius in a way that does it in an extremely efficient way. So there are problems with this method that I think, for example, is statistical issue that we discussed, getting reliable information about independencies and dependencies. This is a problem, especially if you have a large number of nodes, but speed is not. So if you do, you can easily go to, like, we also applied the PC algorithm, for example, to the gene reach dataset, where it's 6,000 genes, so 6,000 variables, and it took, I think, even like estimating the cause effect in total half an hour. So they have very reliable code for this. And maybe I write this down. So there's an R package called PCALC. So this is developed by Mark Kalisch et al. There's an R package that includes not only the PC algorithm, but many other methods by now. And they have usually very efficient methods. So the PC stuff, for example, is all done in C. And this is like for practical purposes, right? By the end of the week. Yeah, so I mean, you just stop whenever you think you need to do that. So the question is, the acyclicity assumption, does it exclude feedback loops? And indeed, this is the case. So a lot of the analysis becomes easier if you don't have cycles. But also a lot of these things can be done if you allow for cycles. So maybe to give sort of two hints where problems occur. So one is the very first thing that we saw is how to get a distribution out of a structured equation model. You have to be a bit careful with this, right? So imagine that y is always 2 times x plus some noise, and x is always 2 times y plus some noise. There's not really a distribution to this. So if you think about the dynamic system letting this evolve, this somehow explodes. So somehow you now, if you allow for cycles, you have to be a bit careful what are the corresponding distributions, for example. And often what people think about are equilibrium distributions. And you can make this becomes a bit more complicated, but it's all doable. These structural equation models, for example, these restricted structural equation models, there's work by Moy et al. So this can also be extended there.
have just one environment, is it a smart trick or a bad trick to artificially create this environment? I mean, I have 1,000 subjects, could make, okay, just people subjects and just male subjects, or just subject test in the morning, in the evening. So you can do it, you can lead a lot of different separation requirements, and that's a lot of.
Okay, so the question is, what happens if you only have one environment? Can you sort of artificially create new environments? So again, to answer, the first one is, if you only have one environment and you only plug in one environment, what the method will do is, it's very easy to see, it will output the empty set. Because it really makes use of the difference between environments. So if there's only one environment, it doesn't give a wrong answer, it just gives a useless answer, it says, I do not know. Can you create environments artificially? It's a very good question. So again, last week, Peter Willmann, Nikola Meinthausen, and me were discussing this at breakfast. So now there's a PhD student working on exactly this problem. Because the answer is not trivial, but we think it's somehow possible. So one thing that you should not be doing is, you should not create environments by conditioning on effects of Y. But if you, for example, know that one variable is certainly a cause of Y or an ancestor, then you can use this for generating environments. Very good point. But you are more than happy to try. You're not saying, we haven't solved this problem, but we think it's interesting and we will work on it then.
So there is a lot of work in cognitive science working on the idea of one and showing that people are actually very good in discovering those structures. Even babies can do it. How about ideas two and three? Do you think that humans intuitively can do something like that?
Okay, so everyone got the question, I think. So there's a psychologist or cognitive scientist who is now, there are two experiments being done right now. So one is, if you use MS Mechanical Turk and show scatter plots to people, they will be confused. So they won't, I mean, we have some idea now about what an additive noise model looks like, so we could maybe guess what the structure could be, but an average person who has never seen anything about statistics cannot. There's one application of this idea that you can test. And this sounds a bit crazy now. So in a time series model, in a linear time series model, you can do the same trick of these restricted structural equivalence models to prove that the time direction is identifiable. So whenever you have a time series model that is linear with non-Gaussian noise, for example, the time direction is not invertible. It's not the same model if you invert the time direction. And now suddenly, this is something you can show to humans. And this is, people are doing this. So what happens is they're showing like a point moving around and like within like additive noise model, and then it's just a 2D structure and it's this point moving, and then you have to guess whether it's going in one direction or the other. And this goes very much into the direction of an additive noise model, for example. And so I mean it's ongoing work, and apparently they have positive results. It's not published yet, but I was quite surprised. I'm not sure, maybe one last high-level answer. It's a very good point. How do humans do this in practice? And I'm not so sure whether we are doing this. I think we are working a lot on sort of transferring knowledge and doing interventions. But it's a longer discussion we should do offline.
Let's thank Janet.
Okay, so just before we go for coffee, we thought that maybe we could take a group picture after the song's lecture, and we can try to go to this Parque Genovese, which is this garden in front of the university. We can try to take a group picture in front of the sea. So that could be just before lunch, after next lecture. Okay.